to start tonight with reading from 2 Timothy. Oh, we need a... We need another... I ran out of... handouts. But thank you, Shalom. 2 Timothy, and we'll read the first chapter, the first 14 verses. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, according to the promise of the life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve, as did my ancestors, with a clear conscience, as I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you, that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, dwells in you as well. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share in suffering for the gospel by the power of God, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, and which now has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, for which I was appointed a preacher and apostle and teacher, which is why I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and am convinced that he is able to guard until that day what has been entrusted to me. Follow the pattern of the sound words that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus by the Holy Spirit who dwells within us. Guard the good deposit entrusted to you. So far, God's word. Let me lead you in prayer. Father in heaven, at the beginning of this time together, as we talk about our creeds and our confessions, and as we learn more about you through these creeds and confessions, we pray that you will help us open our hearts and our minds so that we can learn from it. We pray that you'll take care of us, give us a good evening together, a good evening of discussion and surrounding ourselves with your word. We thank you for what you've given us. Hear us not that we deserve it, but for Jesus' sake. Amen. So, Pastor Tim and I have been talking about this for quite some time. And so it's really fun to get this going now. I should tell you, back many years ago, when I was being examined by the consistory in Burlington, Ontario, one of the questions they asked me was, tell me about... Or they asked me about the canons of Dort. And my mind went blank, completely blank. And after sitting there thinking for a minute, I said, well, I can't tell you anything about it except why they were written. They were written against the Remonstrants. Okay, I didn't even know what the Remonstrants were. I just knew it was a nice word and it sounded good. So, and they took that. I think they're probably a little hesitant about admitting me, but they allowed me in. But ever since then, that has stuck in my mind. I got to know these things. And I must admit, at first, it was all head. You get to know these things, they head knowledge you, and you get to know what this article in the Belgian Confession is about, what this Lord's Day is about, all that kind of stuff. I have to admit, it's not until about 2 years ago when I had to actually teach the canons of Dort that I got to really appreciate what's written there. So this is a journey, and I guess that's what I'm going to start off with. This is a journey. It's a wonderful journey. There's a whole lot to be learned, and you never get to the end of learning it. Because this, the creeds and the confessions are wonderful, wonderful ways of getting to know what the Bible is all about. So that's by way of introduction. I hope this is going to work. It looks like it. That was the introduction. Why the creeds and the confessions? Come on now. There we go. There's a lot of criticism about this, and I think I've given you some of these good little reading in here and in this one. These tell us some of the criticisms against our creeds and our confessions. One of them is no creed but Christ. But as soon as you ask that, and I really like what this fellow in here wrote about it, he says, as soon as they say that, they're saying they already have a creed themselves. And as the next question is, so what do you believe about God? And as soon as somebody says, well, this is what I believe about God, you have admitted to a creed. And so that's why the no creed but Christ just doesn't stand up. Then there's the creeds and confessions divide Christians. And in this one again, one of the guys writes, sin divides, doctrine unites. And when we start studying and looking at going through the creeds and our confessions, that you find out how much unity there is. And that's why this one doesn't say it, but we often refer to these as the three forms of unity. Three forms of unity. What brings us together? What can we agree upon? And so it doesn't divide, it brings together. And then finally, creeds become more important than the Bible. And there is a really genuine criticism, because we firmly believe that the Bible is the supreme authority in all of this. But we can very quickly put some of our confessions above what the Bible says. And that's a danger we have to guard against. And I think that's what part of the purpose of Bible study is to do, is to guard us and to protect us from making these things more important than the scriptures. The scriptures are the final, final authority. So I threw this picture on here. Apparently this is a picture of the Council of Constantinople, where on the one side you have the Arians, and on the other side you have the followers of Athanasius, and there you got, this is the churches divided over this. Well, sin divides. And that's what happens when personalities and sinful ways making the scriptures say what you want them to say rather than what they actually say. So one of the great things of the creeds and confessions should not ever replace scripture. So there's short summaries of scriptural truths. And one of the very earliest ones is the Shema in Deuteronomy 6. And we all know this one. It's the Lord our God is one. The Lord is one. Deuteronomy 6. If you got your Bible, verse 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And Jewish people recite that how many times a day? Pastor Tim?
No idea.
But they do it a number of times during the day. And it's a confession. It's a confession about their God. That's who he is. The Lord is one. They are often written, that's just one. We'll get into a whole bunch more later on. But they are often written in response to heresy. So we have Arianism, and that's when we got our Athanasian Creed and the Nicene Creed. They were written against against Arius and Arianism. Which is spelling out in very great detail who the divinity of Christ, who he is. And then our Belgian Confession goes into, it's written against Roman Catholicism in a lot of ways throughout the Belgian Confession. You're going to find little things that underline why it was written. And it's contrary to Roman Catholicism, but at the same time, it's they're writing an apology, Guido de Brea did, over the Radical Reformation. And that Radical Reformation created a lot of havoc. And what Guido de Brea wanted to do was to make sure that the Prince Philip of Spain understood that these reformers were not part of the Radical Reformation. They were sticking with the age-old, centuries-old, ancient, early church doctrines of the church. So that Prince Philip would understand that they were not cult. They were abiding by what the government had put in place, and they wanted to show that they were following what the Bible had said. So, to separate themselves from the Radical Reformation, those radical reformers who went around and smashed church windows and all kinds of icons and all throughout, well, especially in the lowlands, the what is today Belgium, all through that area, which really excited the Catholics, the Roman Catholics. Well, you were creating a whole lot of hatred between the two. And Guido de Brea wanted to make that break. But he also wanted to show them that this was a Catholic, a universal Christian religion. We are tied with that ancient church. I better carry on. Does that make sense? Okay. That's apparently the Shema in Hebrew. So here's, we need a roadmap. And one of the... So we need a roadmap, and one of the ones there's a roadmap that's been used a lot is creation, fall, redemption, and then it was changed to creation, fall, redemption, restoration, and I like to throw in exile. In my work as a counselor, I often deal with exile. I think that God, in his love and his mercy, throws his people from time to time into places of exile to bring them back to him. And so I see that quite often in my work as a counselor. And then I got to thinking, I wonder what kind of biblical proof can I find for that? I thought maybe there might be some pushback on that from you people. And so Deuteronomy 8 gives a really good rendition of that, or it tells, if you abide by all the things that I've done to you, I will bless you. But realize I will punish you because I punish those whom I love. And it's that punishment that I believe is that exile part. Deuteronomy 8, where he, Hebrews picks that up again as well when he, when the Hebrew author says, I will, that God punishes them whom he loves. And I think that that's that, to bring his people back to him. You'll find that exile is shown, and he warns them that this is going to happen in Deuteronomy 28. And he also adds then in Deuteronomy 30, if you call on my name, which is that redemption part, I will bring you back. I will bring you back from all the corners of the earth, and I will resettle you. That's what this is about. This is what God is doing in our lives. And I think it's a that's one roadmap. There's more. So I thought it was Pastor Tim who took us through some of these one day. Just the whole, how you have, God has created us, then there's the fall into sin, but at the same time in Genesis 3:15, there's that promise of that he would send a savior. And so then you get Romans 3. We read that this morning, how no one is good, no one does right. And then you get Romans 5 with the gospel that there is this one who died in our place. And so there's a roadmap. These become confessional statements. Romans 12, finally. And what you have here is basically comes a kind of an outline of our Heidelberg Catechism, where you have sin, salvation, and service. Romans 12 is all about this living a life of sacrifice, of thankfulness to God. And so you got the fall, sin, salvation, and then there's that time of gratitude for the great salvation. For some of us, this is old news. This is old hat. But for me, it's always new. So then you get early Christian creeds and confessions. This is kind of I'm a history lover. And so when I was taking this, first of all, I took it at, believe it or not, the Theological College in Hamilton with a fellow by the name of Dr. Faber. And there were some beautiful things that I learned from this. So you got early creeds, Romans 10, verse 9. If you look at that, you probably all know it. Romans 10, it's verse 9. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. One of the earliest Christian confessions. Incidentally, I should tell you, this is, for us, this is easy to say. Jesus is Lord. For anyone back in those Roman days, anyone saying that, it was a political statement. And it could cost you your life. It cost many people their lives. Jesus is Lord. And then believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. Two parts to that confession. That's Romans 10. Philippians 2. I see that it takes a little bit. Philippians 2, 6 through 11. You have that beautiful chiasm. Hey, how's that, Thomas? We learned that from Mr. Godfrey, hey? Philippians 2. If you take a look at that, that's one of these beautiful confessions of who Christ is. Who he is. Starting at verse 6. Who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death. Now you see the sequence there, all the way till the point of death, even death on a cross, the worst of the worst. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So there he was at the very beginning of time with God. He descended all the way to the bottom, and at the end he's back there full of glory. Glory of God the Father. That's, and then you get 1 Timothy 3:16. 1 Timothy 3, verse 16. It's an interesting little, just a very, every now and then Paul writes, though the statement is worthy of full acceptance, the great indeed we confess is the mystery of godliness. He was manifested in the flesh, vindicated by the Spirit, seen by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed on in the world, taken up in glory. An early Christian confession about who Christ is. And now turning to 1 Corinthians 15, verses 3 through 7. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of them whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. So this is a confession of who Christ is and his resurrection. So, three creeds of the Reformed churches: the Apostles' Creed, Nicene Creed, and the Athanasian Creed. So, where did it go? There we go. And then we got three confessional statements, documents of the Reformed churches: Belgic Confession, Heidelberg Catechism, and the Canons of Dort. And as time goes on, I'll take you through each one of those, hopefully, together with Pastor Tim. Right? The Apostles' Creed. Very interesting. The Apostles' Creed is what we have today comes out of an old Roman creed, and that's it right there. But I wanted to, I was debated on whether I should turn these two slides around that's coming up. Because this is the old Roman creed, and if you look at it, you'll see that it's fairly close to what we have in our Apostles' Creed. There's just a few little changes here and there. I believe in God the Father Almighty. We don't have maker of heaven and earth. But this is very early on in the Christian history. I'll give it to you here. So the old Roman Creed, probably sometime around 150 AD. Now that's according to Mr. Kelly, who wrote quite a tome on the early Christian creeds. So he says it came about probably around 150 AD. So this is, you're looking at only 60, 70 years after the Apostle John wrote his works. So it's fairly early on after after Christ was on the earth, 150 years, like pretty close there. It was, first of all, a baptismal creed. Why does this thing not work sometimes? So there's some, about 100 AD, there's a document that came out that was called the Didache. And it's early documents for teachings of the apostles. Very interesting document if you ever get to read it. Some of it, and it spells out how to how baptism should be done and how the Lord's Supper should be done. And it tells if there's an itinerant pastor, some of these itinerant pastors going from place to place, they had ways of figuring out, is that person someone you could trust? So that's what that Didache did. And then there's this early confession at baptism that had to be made. I believe in God the Father Almighty and in Christ Jesus, his only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Church, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the flesh. Now you see kind of the outline already on that of our Apostles' Creed. And this is very, very early on in our Christian history. Now, out of this baptismal formula came the old Roman Creed, and then from there came our creed. Okay, let's have a little production. Oh, there it goes. Come on, you can do it.
I did it.
Nicene Creed. It was written by two councils. The Council of Nicaea in 325, and then the Council of Constantinople kind of put the finishing touches on it in 381. It was written to explain what the church believed concerning the doctrine of the Trinity. The Western churches, if you read our Nicene Creed, if you've got your blue book with you, you can take a look at that Nicene Creed. If you, the very interesting little thing happened in the Council of Constantinople and Nicaea, I think both of them, you'll notice that when it comes to the Holy Spirit, and we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. You see that? And the Son. Now, those three little words caused a major split in the churches. In 1054 AD, the churches split over that little addition. There's probably more to it, but that the Eastern churches refused to accept and the Son. They still believe the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. They say he only proceeds from the Father, and the Son is there's no connection there between them. And so they had this major split. I just read recently that there are some Eastern Orthodox churches, or actually Eastern Orthodox people, who are saying it's not really that big of a deal. And so they're kind of coming around to, it could be seen as proceeding from the Father and the Son. So they're, but they, early on in 1054, they saw it as a heresy. They considered it a heresy to see the Holy Spirit coming from the Son as well. And I just don't know what they do with those texts in Matthew where Christ says, I will send you the Comforter. That kind of says to me that he proceeds from the Father and the Son. So, but this one, the Nicene Creed spells out the Trinity in a much stronger way, because there were so many different heresies hanging around at the time about who Christ was. So you had Arianism, which, my mind went blank on what he was doing. Arian. Didn't believe. Help me out here, Pastor Tim.
Arius was, to make a comparison, not that far off from the modern day Jehovah's Witness.
Oh, yeah.
Who he ascribed glory to Christ, but glory as the first of God's created beings. So
right.
Therefore, the Son was not eternal, but
right.
Was created.
Yeah.
And the church believed that that was not at all faithful to the teaching of the Scripture and confessed that in that century.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks. So that's the main focus of the Nicene Creed and the Athanasian Creed, actually, that also included in there. This will probably skip right on through. There we go. Athanasian Creed. If you get a chance, read the story of Arius and Athanasius and the controversy between those two. Both of them were excommunicated at one time. Both of them were reinstated at one time. And finally, and all came to a head in one of the councils. I think it was Council of Constantinople. It all comes to a head there. And that's where they council sided with Athanasius. I think rightly so, like really rightly so. Arius was, well, what Pastor Tim said, there's just no scriptural basis for what he's saying. So it's in, there is a very interesting thing is the Athanasian Creed has been influenced by Augustine and the Ambrose of Milan as well. Ambrose being the bishop in Milan at the time as well. But there was some strong influence there from Augustine. And it sets forth the deity of Christ, that he is eternal God. He is with God the Father and the God the Son. He is God the Holy Spirit, and with God the Holy Spirit. That sets that out. And then it's written against three heresies. So there's probably more, but more of the refinement of the Nicene Creed against Arius. But then there was this monophysite heresy. Jesus was not only not totally human or totally divine. He had manifestations. You could see some things. There was great things about him, but he wasn't totally human, neither was he totally divine. And then you have Nestorianism. Jesus was actually two persons who were closely connected. One was divine, and the other was human. So then I found this really fascinating little thing that kind of spelled it out fairly well. The Father, God, he is God, the Son is God, the Holy Spirit is God, but the Father is not the Holy Spirit. Actually, if you really, one of the best books I've read recently on this is the chapters in a book by Nabil Qureshi. The one that I really recommend is Seeking Allah, Finding Jesus. And he spells out how this, it's just beautiful how he comes to realize that Allah is just not it. And the God of the scriptures is it. And he becomes fully convinced of the Trinity. And it's a beautiful confession from that man, Nabil Qureshi. Highly recommend it. Conclusion. Our creeds and confessions often come out of heresies, and they come out as defenses of our faith. And they're often put in writing what is already we have in Scripture, and they become an incredibly good map to get us through the Bible. And they separate Christians from heretics. That was my part of the presentation, but I also put all a bunch of questions in there in your last page of your notes. These are questions I pulled out of those readings that I gave you from the table talk. So, as I was reading that table talk and Wes Bradenhoff's thing, Wes actually, if you've got your book with you, some of you may need one. Wes actually has some really good little points in there. The two metaphors that he has, I use the roadmap metaphor. He also has another one. It's a grammar. How to learn a language. When we are taught French in school, we learn the grammar of the French so that we can speak it later on. And that's kind of what he says is our confessions as well. They are there to teach us how to start looking at speaking the language of the Bible. I thought that was those are two really good metaphors of what confessions do. The other thing is his rationale for why we have confessions. He gives five reasons. They're there for teaching. So we have the Heidelberg Catechism. It's great for teaching. But I've been teaching to the young people in Houston, the Belgian Confession and the Canons of Dort, and they are great tools. I love teaching them. That's, I think, one of the blessings of our confessions. They're great teaching tools. They're there for unity. We call the Reformed Confessions the three forms of unity. These are biblical truths which we rally around. And then they're for a testimony. They testify to the world out there who we are. That's what they were written originally for. Guido de Bray wrote them as a testimony of this is what we stand for. And if you read what he wrote to Prince Philip, it's pretty over the top. He said, to protest against the cruel oppression and to prove to the persecutors that the adherents of the Reformed faith were no rebels. And he had said, we will offer our backs to stripes, our tongues to knives, their mouths to gags, and our bodies to the fire, rather than go against what these confessions say. So it's that's quite a testimony. And then for protection, the creeds protect us from heresies that could creep into our churches. And that's what these creeds and confessions, they when you know them, then the heresies do not creep in nearly so quickly. Because you've got something to help you with protecting yourself with. You can use them to protect. And then finally, they're there for praise. He says, to the praise, the confessions also have a doxological purpose and function. Doxological is a big word for helps us to praise. The church lays out these doctrines from the Bible so that her members would grow in praise and adoration of God. And if you got your book with you, just turn with me to, as a show of praise, Article 37 of the Belgian Confession. I'll give you the page number here in a minute. Page 44. Page 44, the last line of that, the article. This is the summary of all the articles, 37. It comes to this. Therefore, we look forward to that great day with a great longing to enjoy to the full the promises of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. All right, so it always ends with a time of praise. Now, if you've got your books open, turn with me to the Canons of Dort. Start with Article 1. The very first one, Head of Doctrine, Election and Reprobation, and then you turn to Article 16, that one, the last line, take a look at that last line, they should be even less terrified by the doctrine of the reprobation since a merciful God has promised not to snuff out the smoldering wick, nor to break the bruised reed. Always still, whoops, sorry, I should have gone to Article 18, because he ends with a hymn of praise, Romans 11, 33 to 36. We, however, with reverent adoration of these mysteries, exclaim with the apostle, oh, the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay him? For from him and through him and to him are all things, to him be the glory forever. Then you get the rejection of errors. And then take the second head of doctrine. Take it to page 115. And there you've got Article 9, the fulfillment of God's counsel. The very last sentence, once again. This church shall steadfastly love and faithfully serve him as her Savior, who as bridegroom for his bride laid down his life for her on the cross, and celebrate her praises here and through all eternity. Now take a look at head 3 and 4, last article in that one. Article 17, last line again in Article 17, this is page 125. To God alone, both for the means and for their saving fruit and efficacy, all glory is due throughout eternity. Amen. And then take a look at the fifth head of doctrine. Article 15, page 135. Each one of these, by the way, you'll notice that they are ending with a hymn of praise. So the last sentence of the game. The bride of Christ, on the other hand, has always loved this doctrine, most tenderly and defended it, steadfastly as a treasure of inestimable value in God, against whom no counsel can avail and no strength can prevail, shall see to it that she will continue to do so. To this, God alone, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be honor and glory forever. This is what Bredenhoff is talking about. They bring us to praise. The end result is our hearts end up standing in praise and honor of our God. Okay, questions? If you got this, you got Muther, page 11 in here. Page 11, he says, what are creeds? I thought his answer to that, creeds, this is on the page 11, the top of the page there. Creeds are very short doctrinal affirmations that are generally embraced by the church universal. It's an interesting way of stating it. They are embraced, very short doctrinal affirmations that are generally embraced by the church universal. So it's, and it's a, on a, any given Sunday morning from our time, say 1 o'clock in the morning, till our time, 12 o'clock at night, somewhere in the world, the Apostles' Creed, Nicene Creed, or Athanasian Creed is being confessed by God's people. It's universal. And somewhere, somehow, somebody's, and maybe different languages, but it's always being somewhere being confessed. So, and that's the beauty of it, isn't it? When we confess it here today, we're not alone. We are not the only ones doing this. There's thousands, millions of people across the world who are saying this same confession. confession, this creed, as we are on this day. That always excites me. I should make one comment, and that is this. This afternoon, we did the Apostles' Creed out of the Trinity Psalter. And I don't know if you noticed, but there's a difference between what the Trinity Psalter has in the Apostles' Creed and our Apostles' Creed. Anyone notice?
Christian Catholic?
Yeah. Believe it or not, that's a very, very recent addition only within the Canadian Reformed Churches. I have to admit that I'm not totally for it either, because it happened in 1983 at a synod in Cloverdale, 1983, and Reverend Vanuni takes complete ownership of this. It was his doing, and he apologizes for it. He said it, and it got put in the creed. And I know that there were many synods after that that dealt with it, and in the end result, they left it. And so in a way, we don't confess the exact same creed as everybody else in the world. Ours has this word Christian in it.
Why do you not agree with it?
Ah, thank you. Any church worth its salt is Christian. If it's not a church worth its salt, if it's not living up to it, it's no longer a church. And so that's why I say what you've got here, it's redundancy. It's redundant. And that's why we don't need the word Christian in there. If it's a follower of Christ, it's going to be Christian. That's why. I think there, if you go back in some of our clarions way back, our church magazine, way back, if you go back to the 80s, you'll see article after article after article in the clarion about why Christians should not be in the creed, and then another article that says why it should be there, and it goes back and forth for quite a number of years, a good 10, almost 15 years that debate went on. So he was against it. He was actually against it because he said it was my fault. I should never have said this. And it got included in, because he was a delegate at that synod. Yeah. Professor Faber was totally opposed. And Professor Faber, he was a scholar, a real scholar when it comes to our creeds. And the stuff he would come across, the stuff that he's written so much on our creeds and confessions. Yeah.
Does it imply that the Roman Catholic Church is not Christian?
It doesn't. Well, by putting that in the creed, yeah, it could imply that. I don't think they ever wanted to make that distinction. But I do know that, yeah, there may have been in the back of the minds of some of those. Though, back in those days, in 1983, the great debate wasn't whether, contra the Roman Catholics anymore. It was more, boy, the Canadian Reformed Church has had a hard time understanding the universality of the church. And so there's all kinds of debates on that, what that means. And so then you get some of the Presbyterian side with their visible and invisible church. And they're trying to make some distinctions here. Yeah. Yes, Jeff.
So say in point E,
to who Christ is. So in that way, you're, if you've talked to a someone who's Roman Jehovah's Witness, then you, yes. That's an excellent, excellent question. Simply, it's a question I often ask myself. And now you have talked, mentioned the Athanasian Creed, so why don't we take out all the redundancy? We would almost end up with the Nicene Creed if we did that, right? But I think the point here in the Athanasian Creed is to really drive home the divinity of Christ, the divinity of the Holy Spirit, the divinity of God the Father, so that there was no question about that. But your question, the further question that I see with yours, why don't we have more creeds? Maybe more, like, deal with some of the heresies that are going on in the world today, for example. Okay? And how are they attacking the church? Good question. This is one for Pastor Tim. Oh, Kevin's got it.
Well, I was just thinking about the Athanasian Creed and your question. I think there's a lot of value remembering, like, if we keep some of the focus, then it causes that question, why do we have that? And it brings you back to history, and you study history, then you're not as likely to repeat an error. If we were to shorten it, would be easily forgotten, I would think, and that danger could creep back into the church potentially someday. But if, yeah, if you read that, you go, what is that? And we read that history. Just a thought.
Yeah. Yes, go ahead. Recall years ago, this is a little confession time, I guess. Back in a long, long time ago, there was an organization, I don't know if it's still around, maybe Kevin can help me. It was called the Association for the Advancement of Christian Scholarship. Do Do you remember those days, the ACS? Oh man, we were a heady bunch, I tell you. And at that time, they really believed that we should have a new creed written, especially when it comes to education and what constitutes education. There are some really good points they had, but it never got off the ground. Why? It's simply because of what Pastor Tim says. You have to be so incredibly careful that what you say, if you're going to write it down into a creed, it resonates with the scriptures. The scriptures are the final authority, and if they are not being followed, and if you're saying something extra biblical, this is not going to fly. It just doesn't, and people are going to see it and know it. Now, yes. Yes.
And that's for our denomination. So it's, wouldn't it just be totally a different ballgame, I guess, in a way, to write a creed nowadays? Because the churches are so, in every direction, it feels like.
I think that you would find that, if the Canadian Reformed Church wrote their own creed, you would discover that it would not be universal. And that, I think, is one of the criteria, hallmarks of a creed or a confession, that it becomes universal, that people who are scripture reading, scripture believing people are going to hold on to it and say, yes, this is me, this resonates with me. There are other creeds and confessions, especially confessions out there that are we could adhere to too, as well. Lots of them are, like the Westminster Confession. We don't use it in our three forms of unity, but it's a good, good confession. And it was written 100 years after some of our confessions. So they're dealing with a whole different going on. So they're dealing with issues that are happening at that time. Any more later ones? Do you know what? Here's one of the beautiful things about especially our Heidelberg Catechism. I was working with the kids from Houston on this, and I said, if you take a look at what we've got in the Heidelberg Catechism, it belongs to you. Personally, and then universally with a whole lot of other people, because it's a very personal thing. Whereas you look at the Westminster Confession, as beautiful as it is, it's not nearly as personal. It doesn't say, I believe. It says, what's the chief end of man? The chief end of man is to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. It's beautiful. I love that. If it said, I need to praise God and enjoy Him forever, that makes it a little bit more mine. And you'll notice that the Belgian Confession says, we believe. Each one of them starts, we believe. So it's very personal. Others? Yes, Tanisha. Especially like when if you take it back to 1054 and that major split between East and West, remember that statement that Muther, I think, says it, sin divides, doctrine unifies. sanctifies. And there's, I think there's truth in that. We, you're going to find people are, we're sinful people. Hey, we read that in Romans 3. You read that in Jeremiah. We are sinful. We want things our way. And so we are going to take it our way. And when something does not fit with who we are, we're going to want to change it. And I think what happens is that sin creeps in and we say, well, let's just tone this down a little bit. I'll give you an example. It's not a good example. I was thinking of in Article 36 of the Belgian Confession, there's a little asterisk in it that says, because Guido de Bray, when he wrote the Belgian Confession, he was talking about Anabaptist people. And I don't know any Anabaptist person today who would go around smashing windows. He was talking the radical Reformation. These were, and so there's an asterisk in our Belgian Confession that says, and it says Anabaptist and other seditious people. Well, there's asterisks that say they're not like that anymore. Yes. There's a possibility of sifting through this whole business that we're going through now. There's one of our former pastors was telling us that it's a time of sifting for the churches, and it can only be good, though we're going to suffer, and that's. But God will take care of it. We heard that this afternoon. The providence of God. He's got it. He's got it under control. What about those questions on this sheet, or are you ready for singing?
Always ready for singing.
What's that? Always ready? So then there's the creeds. What are confessions? Number one, to call the church to return to historic creeds and confessions and to affirm them faithfully. What does it mean by that statement? Well, we kind of talked about that. Especially just now with what Kevin was saying, it brings us back. It brings back the church. And I think that's, church is in that case, is much broader than just our denomination. It's much broader than that. It brings us back so that we all are circled around those creeds. And once again, we see the beauty of them, and we once again see the comfort in them. And then the 10 purposes of creeds and confessions that Parson, Bravenhoff had 5 reasons, purposes. And here's Parson's with 10. And I added there, which one surprised you? And I have to admit, there's a couple that surprised me. So if you got that, it's on page 2 of this table talk. And he says, to glorify God, to affirm the one true God Almighty, to guard the unchanging sound doctrine, to discern truth from doctrinal error, and discern truth from half-truth, to remain steadfast through the ages, to uphold the life-encompassing doctrine of the inspired and inerrant Word of God, to maintain freedom for Christians from extra-biblical laws, number 8, to confirm men according to the Church's doctrinal standard, number 9, to preserve the purity and thereby the peace and unity of the church, visible as the outward witness of Christ to the world. And finally, to fulfill the Great Commission. Which one surprised you the most? Christians from extra biblical laws, traditions, and superstitions that bind people's consciences. And that's one of the fears of putting together our own creeds, because are you going to bind our consciences to something that's extra biblical? And that's a major fear, but that's also a major, and that's why the confessions are good guards. Yeah. Yes. Confirmed men, according to the church's doctrinal standard, who have been elected to serve as office bearers of the church, and to equip, examine, and prove those men. I wasn't so much that I was surprised to see that there. I just thought of how I signed a form of subscription last week regarding an eldership here, and how I had to sign that I would hold these three forms of unity and would not speak against them. So I'm interested to see that he added that in there. Confirm it. You must have had to do the same at one time. Yeah. It's a, I like, I think it was this one of these guys that I'm in here who said it's a roadmap. Oh, and it's and Bradenhoff said the same. It's a roadmap. You can follow the map, but you can also get very lost if you don't follow the map. And I think that's one of the really good safeguards of our confessions. They're a roadmap. You follow the roadmap, you won't get lost. You won't get lost. The long and short of it. They're going to keep you focused. They're going to keep you, and if you do a wrong turn, they're going to be there to say, hey, you took a wrong turn.